Okay. Nehemiah chapter 6 and verse 3. It's going to be our text this morning. Nehemiah 6, 3, and I sent messengers unto them saying, I am doing a great work, so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease whilst I leave it and come down to you? Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for this morning. Thank you for this time. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to gather here this morning and hear your word. Now, Lord, these people came to hear from you, not from me. So please use me, use my thoughts, my words. They'd be words that you want your people to hear this morning. We put this message into your hands. We thank you. We love you for all you've done. Thank you for this church, Lord. Help this church keep being a light and a blessing to this community, Lord, and that people can get saved and that people can come to the knowledge of salvation through this ministry. We love you. We thank you. We put this time into your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Nehemiah chapter 6 and verse 3, we find Nehemiah working in the work of the Lord. Now, for a lot of time's sake, I can't explain everything that's happening here, but we basically know, and I believe that you guys are known for your Bible. We know that Nehemiah had a job to do. His job was to restore the temple and restore the gates or the pillars of where the church was and where the temple was at this time. And that was his calling. That's what the Lord used him for, and that's what the Lord used him for in his life. His whole life was to dedicate to do that, to restore the temple and to lift up again the pillars and just get everything going again. So that Israel can come and worship God, and Israel can come and be a part of the worship service of God. And in chapter 6, verse 3, we see here Nehemiah has an answer to something that other people came to him to do. Nehemiah was focused in what he needed to do. And Nehemiah is a good example of a person who is focused and determined to finish what God has sent him to do. A lot of times we as Christians lose the focus. A lot of times we as Christians, God shows us something to do, or God gives us something to do, and because we don't stay focused and because we let other things around us lose the focus of what we need to do for God. And a lot of Christians today do this, because they don't maintain the focus on what is to be done. And Nehemiah is a perfect example here, because in verse 3, and the verse that we read, it says here, and I sent messengers unto them saying, I am doing a great work. If you're going to do anything for God, if anything you do for God is something great, anything you do for God is something great, it's a privilege to work in God's work. It's a privilege to serve God. It's not an obligation, and it's not something that I have to do, but if God calls you to do something, it's something great. God doesn't just do things for little things or for things that don't matter. If God calls you to do something, even if it's just sweeping the floors or cleaning the toilets or going out street preaching or being a pastor or being a missionary, whatever God calls one to do is something great, and it's great in his eyes. And we cannot have anybody or anything let us lose the focus in what we need to do for the Lord. The Bible says there that Nehemiah said that I'm doing a great work. And I'm telling you right now, if you're serving God, if you're doing something for God, no matter what degree it is or no matter what it is, if you're doing something for God, you're doing a great work for the Lord. And don't let anything or anybody or any other thing have you lose the focus in what you're doing. What we're going to talk about this morning is this, is losing the focus. And Nehemiah is a good example. Nehemiah is a good example of someone who did not lose the focus. Because like I said, a lot of Christians today lose the focus. And leave whatever God has told them to do, or whatever God has shown them to do, they leave it to one side, they leave it and they abandon that work, and the work of God doesn't get complete. And today, this morning, I want to talk about this, and I want to be able to show you the importance to maintain focus and maintain what the work that whatever God has called you to do. Now, when I call up, when I say of a work, like I said, it could be anything. It could be something as little as, you know, taking care of the church or being the pastor of the church. We all have something to do for the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you look for something to do, be careful with that, because a lot of times people just look for stuff to do, and we shouldn't be looking for something to do. We should have God showing us what we need to do for the Lord Jesus Christ. I know a lot of men who look for work. And there in Colombia, a lot of men, they learn a little Bible, and they learn a little bit of a Bible, and they automatically think that they're called to be pastors, and they're called to be the same level as I am or anything else. And I tell them, no, you don't look for stuff. You just sit there, and God will show you what you need to do in time. And when God shows you this, you'll know that that's a calling, and you know that's a work that God wants you to do. Because a lot of times they make the mistake of thinking the calling, and then they it's not a calling. It was just something in the flesh that they wanted to do, and God wasn't in it. So don't take for granted that you can do something for God. Don't take for granted that you can serve God, because whatever we do for God is a great work. And that's what we need to stay focused on, doing the work of God. And so it says there, and I sent messengers, verse 3, and I sent messengers unto them, saying, I am doing a great work, so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease? Okay. One of the problems in losing focus is the probability of the work what? Stopping. Of the work stopping. And that's why it's so important to maintain the focus. And that's why it's so important that we maintain this focus, because God is depending on us to do this work. And God is depending on us for you to complete whatever he showed you to do. Now, I know God doesn't need us, and God can do everything, and that's true, but sometimes God depends on us to do something. And God depends on us to be able to complete whatever he has called us to do. And when we lose that focus, when we lose that focus in what God has shown us to do, sometimes the thing that suffers most is what? The work that God has shown us to do. And so that person who's cleaning the bathrooms, who's just, you know, a regular church member just helping the church, when you lose the focus of that and you don't do it anymore, now that hinders the work of God. And now I'm just talking something basic, but if we get to the level of missionary or pastor or someone, a leader in that capacity, sometimes it's very hard to recuperate a work or a position of someone who just let the thing go. And just let it go because he lost the focus. He lost what God has showed him to do. So there in verse 3 it says that, so I cannot come down. Why should the work cease? The work of God should never cease. The work of God should always keep going. The work of God should always keep plowing. The work of God should always keep just going and going and going. And it should never cease, the work of God. And sometimes we as Baptists look bottom class. Okay, or look, comparing to all these, you know, mega churches and things like that. Now, I know God's not in that kind of stuff. And I know God's not in that kind of stuff. But just comparing, you know, what we can do, a lot of times we stay at this level because people just get bored and people just lose the focus. And when that focus gets, when we lose the focus, the thing gets put away on one side. And while other churches are growing, other churches are getting bigger, we're just trying to pick up the pieces because people are just losing the focus instead of just on concentrating on what God has them to do and just on concentrating on what God called them to do. It says there in verse 3 also, whilst I leave it and come down to you. And so we can't, Nehemiah was basically saying, listen, okay, I'm doing God's work, and I'm trying to do something for God, and whatever problems are, you know, on one side or whatever things are on the other side, I'm not going to stop, and I'm not going to stop because I'm doing something for God. I need to finish what God has told me to do, and whatever things are around me or whatever things are all around me, I'm not going to stop because I'm doing something for the Lord. I'm doing something for the Lord. And just quickly this morning, I want to give you three things on how Nehemiah. That's in Spanish. Nehemiah. I want to show you three things Nehemiah did not to lose the focus. Let's go to verse 1, first of all. Verse 1. Now, if it came to pass when Sambala and Tobiah and Gershom and Arabian and the rest of our enemies heard that I had builded the wall and that there was no breach left therein, though that time I had not set up the doors upon the gates, that Sambala and Geshem sent unto me, saying, come, let us together in some of the villages in the plain of Ono. But they thought to do me, what? Mischief. Okay? Sometimes we lose the focus because we put our focus on who we shouldn't focus. Okay? Nehemiah said he wasn't going to go to them because he knew that they weren't no good. That all they wanted to do was cause him what? Mischief. And that's what a lot of people do. Satan uses people, okay, to distract us and lose the focus on what we need to do for the Lord. And if sometimes we pay more attention to people, okay, and instead of God, that's how we start losing the focus. And I use an example of this is when I got called to go to Colombia, and I mentioned it to my mom, and I mentioned it to my family. Everybody just started, going crazy. Oh, how are you going there? How can you be there? How can you go there? And all that kind of stuff. And people are just getting all bent out of shape, and people are just trying to tell me and push me in a way that if I would have listened to them, I would have lost the focus of what God wanted to do in Colombia. And sometimes, if we listen to people more than we listen to God, that's when we start losing the focus. And we can't listen to the people. If Nehemiah would have, now Sambala, we all know, Tobiah and Geshem, they were the enemies of this whole project. They were the enemies. And from chapter 1 and chapter 2, you can understand that if you go back and read it, that they were against Nehemiah doing this work. And obviously, if Nehemiah would have listened to them and done what they wanted to do, he would have lost the focus. And sometimes people just lose the focus because they listen to people rather than God. Some people are not in church this morning because they listen to people instead of listen to God. Some people are not serving the Lord Jesus Christ this morning because they listen to people instead of serving the Lord. I had a national pastor, and now I'm pastoring the church in Montenegro because I have to. Okay, I don't consider myself a pastor. I consider myself a church planner. I plant the church, and I like to give it over to a national pastor so they can keep the work and keep pastoring the work. I had the church in Montenegro, the one I showed you, the first one, had a national pastor, and he had a national pastor. He was there for a long time, at least about 5 or 6 years. And then one day he comes up to me and tells me, I'm leaving. And I'm like, okay. And then like, why are you leaving? He's like, no, God told me that I need to go do something else. I'm like, okay, you sure it's God? He's like, yeah, I'm sure it's God. Okay, well, if it's God, who am I to argue? I can't, if it's God that told you this and you go and do that. But what it turned out to be, he was just listening. I mean, that guy, he can preach. He was a good preacher. He was the Spirit of God was in him, and when he stepped behind the pulpit, so he had a good form to express himself. So what it came out to be was that some other church, a charismatic movement type of church, big conglomerate, this thing and that, tickled his ear, okay. And tickled his ear and say, no, you can, instead of preaching to 20 people, you can come and preach to 500 people, And instead of you winning, earning that little money, we'll give you that much money. But that didn't come out till after. But when he came to me and told me he was leaving, I said, okay, well, if God told you to do, then there's no more to talk about here. Okay, just, you know, just pick up your stuff and leave as soon as possible. Make it as easy as possible for the church, and, you know, and I'll pick up the church. That's not a problem. He left. Not more than 3 months later, he's calling me and begging me to take him back. Begging me to give him the position that he left. And the first thing I told him, I thought you said God told you to do this. If God told you to do this, why did it fall apart? Or why is it not, why aren't you prospering or doing, you know, something for the Lord? If God told you to do this. I don't think God would tell you to do, leave a work, leave people that loved you and that, you know, confide in you, and you just left because you told me that God told you it was to leave. And then he confessed and said, well, you know, I think it was in the flesh. And I'm like, well, you know what? You just got to pay the consequences now. You're not going to come back here and take over this church again. You hurt these people, and these people trusted in you, and you just went for whatever reason or for whatever decision you made. And all because he lost what? The focus. He lost the focus. He started listening to other people and getting persuaded, just like Sambalat and all these three guys tried to do with Nehemiah throughout the whole book. But Nehemiah never listened to them or gave them the time of day for them to try to lose his focus. So we got to be careful until we listen to. We got to be careful of the people that we listen to. And so when going back to my story, my mom, you know, she's all, you know, upset. How are you going back there? How are you going to do this and all that kind of stuff? And the sentimental part, you know, of a mom and a son and things like that. And I basically had to tell her, Mom, you know what? I got to listen to God. I got to listen to God. And I'm not. And I'm sorry you feel that way. And I'm sorry that you feel like I'm doing something that's going to cause danger in my life or whatever. But I need to listen to God. And I need to get on that plane and go to Colombia and do what God has shown me to do. So we just sometimes we need to listen, okay, to God instead of listening to people. Now, you can get opinions, you can get a counsel, okay? I don't see nothing bad with that, but the last word should be what God says. The last word should be what the Lord says. A lot of times people, you know, they tell me something, you know, God told me to do that. Okay, well, can you give me something, the word of God that shows that's what God wants? No, I just feel it. Well, you know, feelings can come and go, feelings can be... deceived, you know. Show me for the word of God, and they don't. So, you know, people, a lot of times people just do what they want to do for feelings and emotions and listening to other people instead of listening to God and just keeping focus on what God wanted them to do. Okay, number one, well, we lose focus when we lose when we listen to other people. Number two, let's just go down here in verse 10. It says in verse 10, afterward I came to the house of Shemiah, the son of Delaiah, the son of Mehetabel, who was shut up. And he said, let us meet together in the house of God within the temple, and let us shut the doors of the temple, for they will come to slay thee. Yea, in the night will they come to slay thee. Okay? Sometimes we lose the focus for threats. Sometimes we lose the focus for threats. I remember, and I tell this because not because of, you know, I'm no one spiritual or, you know, super spiritual or anything like that. But 3 months in Colombia, getting there to where I was at, my house was robbed. My house was robbed. Now I say you're not a missionary until you get robbed. Okay? Any missionary that comes to Colombia, they tell me, give me some counsel, give me some advice. I said, well, you're not going to be a missionary until you get robbed. So 3 months, 3 months into where I'm living in Montenegro and getting situated, getting everything going, I was dealing with some men, and it turned out that these men were the ones that robbed my house. And then when I left town for a weekend or something like that, and when I came back, I opened up the door. And when I opened up the door, walk in the living room, the computer used to be there, was not there. You know, this thing that was there was not there. And you know, they just They just they robbed everything that was of value. And on the note, on the table, there was a note. And on the note, it says, if you say anything to the police, we know where you are, we will kill you. Basically, that's what it said, the note. And if I would have paid attention to that note, if I would have let that threat, if I would have let that threat, you know, bother me or let it affect me, all the stuff that you saw there in them slides wouldn't come to be. If I would have said that at that time right there, no, oh, they're gonna kill me, they're gonna do stuff to me, they know where I live and all that stuff, I gotta pack my bags, I gotta get out of here. What would have happened to all them pictures that I just showed you? That wouldn't have come to, wouldn't have come to pass. So sometimes we can't have the threats bother us or affect us. Now, I'm not just talking about a physical threat. I'm not just talking about a physical threat where your life is in danger. And a lot of times, us as missionaries in foreign countries, you know, it can become like that. It can become like that, especially these missionaries that go to, you know, like these Middle Eastern countries and things like that. They got to live underground, you know, China and things like that. And that's understandable, okay? And that's part of the thing that I think that's what God already deals with us even before we commit to the work. You know, I knew Colombia was dangerous. I knew Colombia was nothing nice. But I wasn't going to let that or the threats ruin my focus on what God wanted me to do in Colombia. And when I saw that note, you know what? I said, okay, obviously they needed this stuff more than I needed. Okay? And I'm not going to call the police. I'm not going to do nothing. I mean, I'm not going to be stupid either and try to, you know, go fight a fight or pick something that fight or nothing like that. No. Okay, I just put it all in the Lord's hands. And you know what? 3 months later, a new computer came. A couple months after that, this other thing came. And a couple months after that, this other thing came. And eventually, everything that was stolen was replaced by God. And I didn't do one single thing. There was 3 men who entered my house that night. Supposedly, 3 men. 2 of the men are dead now in Colombia. 2 of them. And 1 of them I see every day in Colombia. You know how that must eat him, knowing that I know that he was the one that robbed my house that day, and that I never went and put a report or did anything or said anything. His conscience himself. You know what he does sometimes when I'm walking down the street or walking around the village? If he's coming this way, if I'm coming this way, he's coming this way, he'll detour and go the other way. And he was doing that for a while. And one time I went after him. And I, because we were walking, he detoured. And I'm like, hey man, listen. His name is Juan. I said, Juan, come here. Why do you run away every time you see me? He actually calls me Pastor. He says, well, right, Pastor, you know, it's like I feel bad, you know. That time when that happened, you know, I'm sorry. And I'm like, hey, man, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. All you need to do is now is just concentrate in your life. Concentrate in what the Lord Jesus Christ did for you and that the Lord Jesus Christ wants to save you. And he hasn't to the day made a confession or anything like that. And I tell him every day, 2 of your friends who you enter that house with right now are in hell. And I don't know why you're living, because you should probably be dead with them. Because they were just, they got killed because they were just thieves. And people, you know, that's how, in Colombia, there's no justice. The justice is taking out the gun and putting away with it. That's it. And I said, I don't know the reason why they were killed, and the reason why they were, they're dead and in hell right now is because of their lifestyle and the things that they did. And I don't know what you're doing now, and I don't know if you're keeping living that life, but one day you're going to come to that place. One day we might come when you're going to be staring down the barrel of a gun and what you're going to do. So we can't let threats stop the work of God. We cannot let threats stop the work. Like I said, it can't be, and it's not always just a threat of a physical, you know. You know, sometimes the wife, you know, the wife said, if you do that, I ain't going to do it. You know, or the kids, no, if you go there, I ain't going to go with you. Okay? And going back to point one, we listen to the people rather than listen to what? To God. Okay? Sometimes the threats are just not just physical threats against death or anything like that, or in that aspect, but sometimes also with our own families. You have a man of God called to do something for the Lord, called to serve God, he called to do something, some work for the God, and the family or the wife or whoever is not 100% with him. And they use the threat, I'll leave you if you do that. Wow, I ain't going to go if you do that. And what does a man do? Sometimes listen to the wife, to the kids, to the family, instead of listening to who? To God. So it's just not physical threats. Sometimes any kind of threat can help us lose the focus and what we need to do for the Lord. Okay, last thing to finish this morning. Let's go verse 9. It says there, for they all made us afraid. They all made us afraid. Okay, let's go to verse 14. The end of the verse 14 says that would have put me in fear. That would put me in fear. Sometimes we lose the focus because we get afraid or we fear what the Lord has put in front of us to do. Sometimes we look at it as too big of a thing. Oh, it's too big for me to leave my job, to leave my home, for me to go to the mission field, or for me to be a pastor, or for me to do something for the Lord. It's just too big. I can't do it. I can't handle it. And sometimes it's fear that let us lose the focus. Fear. You know, when I got called to Colombia, I had no idea. There was nothing written down. There was no there's no manual of instructions. There was no do this, do that, do that. There was nothing. But fear was there. A year before I went to Colombia, and knowing where I was going to go, because I did the survey trip and all that, knowing where I was going to end up. Do you know, some of you might, in 1999, in Armenia, Colombia, which is the capital of the department that I live in, that I showed you, in 1999, that town had the biggest, strongest earthquake that is known to Colombia at this time. 8.9 on the Richter scale. 6,000 people dead. The whole city tumbled. Tumbled. And I went there and I read that and I was like, whoosh. You know, and I'm saying, oh man, that's rough. That could happen again, or that could be an excuse not to go there because, you know, that's a danger and that could be putting my life in danger and things like that. But I couldn't have fear. I couldn't have this fear affect what the Lord has called me to do. I get to Colombia. There's still earthquakes. Last one was about maybe 6 months ago. Now they haven't been as big as that one that destroyed the city that one time, but you know, 5.5, 6.6, you know. One time I'm sleeping in my bed, and my bed's in the corner, and there in the corner against the wall, you know. And sometimes you feel him, sometimes you don't even feel him. And my bed was there. And when I got up the next morning, my bed was in the middle of the living room, part of the room, right there in the middle. And then right away, you know, I must have had an earthquake last night or something like that. You know. So we can't have fear, okay? We can't be afraid of what God has called us to do. If God has called you to do a work, He'll enable you to complete what you need to do. But we can't have fear, and we can't be scared of what God has called us to do. All these things Nehemiah faced. He faced threats, okay? He faced people talking about him, you know, things like that. He faced fear, okay? But during all this time, he did not have these things affect of what he was called to do. We cannot have fear. We cannot have people. We cannot have threats. Let us lose our focus on what the Lord has us to do. We just got to keep focused. You know, imagine how it would have been Noah, you know, while he was building the ark, you know, he was there, you know, hammering, you know, putting wood together and all that. And people coming by and say, hey, you crazy guy, what are you doing, man? It's going to rain. Why rain? Well, it has never rained. What are you talking about rain? And Noah, you know, just kept, you know, pounding and just kept building and just kept, you know, doing what God told him to do. And sometimes that what God calls you to do might seem crazy in front of the world. Might seem crazy in front of your family. Might seem crazy. But you know what? If that's what God called you to do, it's a great work. And you need to keep doing it. You know, and Nehemiah and Noah, you know, just kept doing it. Criticism, you know, people making fun of him. Maybe his own family, you know, saying, hey, you know, what are you doing, man? But one day, one little drop came down. And then two drops. And then three drops. And then four drops. And then millions of drops. And then all the water started going up. Now the people who are making fun of him are not making fun of him no more. Now the people who are laughing at him, making fun of him, and criticizing him want to come in what he built. We can't lose the focus. We can't lose the focus. Paul says in Philippians 3:14, I press toward the mark for the price of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. That's what we need to do. We just need to press toward the mark. Press toward that trumpet sound. Press to, you know, the Lord calls me home or whatever. But just keep doing it. Just keep serving. Just keep praying. Just keep reading. Just keep testifying. Just keep doing what we need to do as Christians. And not let things lose our focus. And to finish, I want to talk of one great man who didn't lose the focus. I want to talk about a man who took the reproach, who took the beatings, who was despised, who was shamed, hung on a cross, naked, made to carry his own cross, made to take the sin of all of us. And I wonder if he lost the focus along the way, what would happen? And I wonder if this man have lost the focus after someone spit on him, or after someone smacked him, or after someone made fun of him. What would have happened if he had lost the focus? But great to God that he didn't lose the focus. Thanks be to God that after every spit, after every hit, after every whip, after everything that he went through, he stayed focused. He kept carrying that cross. He kept walking. He kept going. The Bible says he could have called 10,000 angels. The Bible says that his own father had to turn his back on him. The Bible says that he was made sin for us. But during all that time, he kept the focus. Because he knew what he needed to complete. He knew what he needed to be done. And if he would have lost the focus along the way, none of us would be here this morning. If we would have lost the focus along the way, there would be no salvation for man this morning. But like Nehemiah, he kept the focus. He kept walking. He kept going until he completed his focus, until he completed what was called for him to do. And on the cross, he says, "It is finished. It is finished." Never lost the focus. He pressed toward the mark. He kept going. Because he knew the importance of completing God's work for man's salvation. He kept focus. He kept focus. How you doing this morning, Christian? How you doing in keeping focus? Maybe you're listening to someone you shouldn't be listening to this morning. And they're going to throw you off the path. Maybe you're scared to commit to work for something for God this morning for fear that you can't complete what God has calling you to do. Or maybe you're listening to threats of your family, your boss, your wife, your kids, or a physical threat not to complete what the Lord has called you to do this morning. Whatever your situation is this morning, I encourage you just to keep the focus. And you say, "How do I do that, Brother Perez? How do I do that?" Well, it's easy. The Bible says in Hebrews, keeping our eyes on the author of our faith, which is who? Jesus Christ. As long as we keep our eyes on him, as long as we keep him in the vision, we can complete our work that God has called us to do. Nehemiah did the work because he knew who he was working for was more important than what he was working for. He kept the focus. He fulfilled what the Lord called him to do. The Lord Jesus Christ kept the focus and fulfilled what the Lord called him to do. We this morning need to keep the focus. Keep the focus. Let's pray. I'm just going to start a prayer and then Pastor, I'll hand it over to Pastor Seth. And he can do what he wants to do. But Lord, I just want to pray for you this morning. I just want to pray for these people this morning, Lord. And this is the message you have put in my heart to give to these people. And we know that your word does not bring back void, Lord. And your word penetrates the most inner parts of our hearts, Lord. And for some reason, this message was was to be a priest this morning here. And I pray for this church, Lord. I pray for the people, that they keep the focus, that they keep the focus on whatever you have called them to do, and whatever you have showed them to do in your lives, Lord. And help them to understand, Lord, that whatever work you have given us to do is a great work. It's a privilege. It's a blessing to serve you, Lord, and to do anything for you. So please, Lord, don't let this church lose the focus, Lord. From the top down to the bottom, Lord, to the pastor and to the person just helps, Lord. That everybody stays focused on what they need to do and everybody stays focused on what you have shown them to do. We pray that you just bless this church, Lord. Help them to keep going. And help them always to stay focused and keep toward the mark of the high calling. Thank you. We love you. We put all these things in your hands. Jesus, and we pray. Amen.